Thanks very much. I apologise for missing the first session of your discussion today, but my excuse is that I was implementing the recommendations of the white paper because we had a delegation who visited us from Indonesia, and the conversation embodies much of the points that I wanted to make today, so let me refer to that as we go along. I was involved a little while ago in a project for the Pacific Economic Cooperation Council on what was happening in the education sector in the region, and so what I wanted to talk to you today was about some of the key observations from that exercise. If you go to the PEC website, you can find the full report and the documents that went with it. What we did was talk about what we called a new wave of globalisation in education. And so let me talk about some of the dimensions of that and then bring it back to some ways and implications you might identify then for the white paper strategy. The five trends that we focused on were firstly the mobility of students, what was happening in that respect. I thought when we started, I thought there might be the big switch going on that you know, we'd see a dramatic decline in student mobility and instead dominance of what we found was the second trend, which is the mobility of providers instead of the mobility of students. But actually the demographics are such, according to our colleagues from Korea who participated in the program, that even if there is that second trend, greater mobility of providers and programs, we'll still see growth in the movement of students as well because of the sizes of the populations and the income distributions and the number of students in the relevant age group. So what we thought we were likely to get was therefore a more diversified manner in which there would be international delivery of education. The mobility of programs and providers is something that we see much more of. So especially in the areas from which this university recruits, we see a lot of other universities from Australia, UK or US setting up to provide services markets. That's the provider mobility option, and the program mobility option is where instead of students coming here to study a program, the program might be packaged up and provided to an institution offshore, which would provide it, make it available there to their students. So we get a much more diverse portfolio of options. The other thing we found common across the economies that we looked at was a shrinking share of public funding of education, a rising share of private student provision of education. One of the other trends was greater evidence of international cooperation in research, and international cooperation in research for good reason. Much more focus on that. Even in my language, even looking at research as in a supply chain setting, where different things are done in different locations according to where it makes sense for them to be done. So there's some nice examples of labour-intensive data processing research activities being done in some locations, but as part of a bigger process in which the design is, the question is specified, and the experimental design is specified in one area, but the data collected in another, and the data processed in a third, for example. That's the sort of setup you could imagine. That's one reason why you find growing international cooperation. The other is for good reason, because you'd want to involve different people in different countries where there was a problem that ran across national boundaries. You'd want a bigger group involved. So for all sorts of good reasons, you could see more sophisticated forms of international cooperation in research. Within that environment, we identified a number of challenges that particular institutions would face. Given the growth of demand for tertiary education and the growth of institutions across the region, there's huge demand we'd expect for academic staff. So finding those people, retaining them and training them is a big challenge. Number two challenge we identified was funding research, actually, in these markets. So if you think about, it's particularly a topical issue for us, you think about how the Australian education system works and how there's a link between teaching and education. Essentially, what we do is get funding for teaching students, which comes with a slice that's available for funding research. Increasingly, students are making a bigger contribution to that package. If you have open and competitive markets, then where's the obvious place for the competitors to establish that's in the high margin, low cost faculties, like mine? So you'll get universities like, let me think of something that's topical. I know, Laureate coming in and setting up and probably kicking off with business programs. And that'll make it more difficult for us to... Now, if we're a comprehensive university competing with a teaching-only specialist operation, it could well be difficult for us to sustain this, essentially, again, in my language, sustain the business model that's funding the research that we do. So I think the fallout from this will have to be a conversation about more direct funding of research rather than packaging it up with... the teaching funding. I reckon that's a really big agenda in this environment. It's not unique to us. The same thing happens, for example, telecommunications sector, big telecommunications monopolies. Why were they monopolies? Well, for a variety of reasons, but one was in order to provide uniform services across the country. If you open up the telecom sector to competition, the competitors will come into the high dense areas and knock out the profits that were being used to pay for the services to the isolated areas. So what you have to do is split all that up and have a specific program for access for low, for high cost providers. What I'm saying is we're going to have to do the same sort of exercise in education. And the third challenge, I think, is my colleague's challenge, working with all of us, which is... Gee, there's a lot of options now for internationalisation. There's so many different ways of doing things. Students coming here. So the conversation I've just had was the idea of a program in Bogor in Indonesia where the students would do two semesters here and then they would come and do two semesters here. It would be for a cohort of students from a particular employer in Indonesia, and there would be funding either from the Ministry of Education in Indonesia or the Australian Aid Agency. Cool, that's a lot of players around the table, but that's the way these forms of internationalisation are going. So there's lots of options for us, and we're going to have to think hard about which one suits us, given our identity and profile, how we want to operate, and what's the best model for us. So I think this is all very, in some ways, comfortable. This is core business in what I see as being the philosophy of the white paper, which is about having, apologies again, you've probably talked about this already, but it seems to me the strategy is a very distributed one. It's one that's designed to engage all sorts of organisations, institutions and companies in building a set of relationships with Asia. It's not what they're trying to describe there, it's not a top-down silver bullet approach to this relationship. It's something that they're asking everyone to be involved in. They're trying to paint a picture about what the world would be like and inviting people to think about how they can contribute to that scenario coming about. And institutions like ours are front and centre in that, but we have to operate in this more competitive environment where we've got to make some choices about what the best way is to make that engagement.